Hi, this is Mark Rosen from WCCO-TV, and it's my pleasure to introduce my good friend Ron Henderson, the Fitness King, presenting Motivation, one word to help change your life. Please welcome Ron Henderson.
Welcome to Motivation. I'm Ron Henderson, a.k.a. the Fitness King. On today's show, I'm proud to introduce you to my new friend, Dennis Aberg. He is the author of several books, but more importantly, today we're going to talk about his new book. It's called Want to Be a Real Man. Welcome to the show, Dennis. How are you?
Thank you very much. Very good. Thank you.
Good. I have to say straight out, a lot of people give me books. I read very few of them. I'm at least 70% through with your book.
Oh, thank you.
I like it.
Good.
I like it. So it's exciting. First, before we get into your book, Dennis, tell us a little bit about yourself. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in central Minnesota in a town called Glenwood, kind of a small town. Most of my relatives and my parents came from farms. Mm-hmm. My dad was a mechanic when I was born, and he took correspondence courses to become a radio and TV repairman. So he opened a little shop, and I ended up working in there for him until I was drafted into the Army.
Okay.
And once I got drafted, I left Glenwood and did not return.
Okay, because I know your book, Want to Be a Real Man, what was your family life like? And, you know, because I want to talk later about any of those influences, how it affected even with your writing.
Right. And my family life was kind of the traditional family. My dad worked, and there was five children in the family.
Mm-hmm.
My mother was a stay-at-home mom and took care of the kids mm-hmm. while he was out working, put mm-hmm. in a lot of long hours. And we went out to visit on the farm every weekend and sometimes during the week, which I really enjoyed.
Yep.
So
mm-hmm.
spent a lot of time on the farm and just running around the small town enjoying that atmosphere.
Okay, so pretty balanced, you'd say pretty balanced childhood?
Pretty balanced, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
loving parents?
Loving parents, the whole family was very supportive. We all were Christians. And okay.
So you were a perfect child then.
Oh, I had that. Looking back on it, I was very fortunate for the environment I grew up in.
Okay. So, folks at home, he's saying he wasn't a perfect child, but he was very fortunate to grow up.
Very fortunate, yes.
Okay. So, getting into your book, Want to Be a Real Man. It's an interesting title. Now, when I look at the title, I'm going to show the folks at home, because when you look at that, it's kind of like Superman.
Yeah.
Okay? Give me some thoughts behind it. You've been coming up with the cover.
Actually, the cover I published through Zulon Press, which is the largest self-publishing Christian book publisher.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And they came up with the design, and when I saw it, I really liked it because it's it doesn't show any kind of Superman image. It's just, but it gives you that implication that it's a real man, that he's capable of taking care of his family, protecting his family, providing, being a leader in the community.
Mm-hmm.
Protecting the community. So being a real man to me, it was something that the Lord just put on my heart to write, mm-hmm. seeing the need for men to step up, be accountable, be responsible in society. Mm-hmm. And
yep.
we're starting to see more and more women be the leaders, and and men are not always picking up the roles they should mm-hmm. be.
Now, was it from meeting different men and noticing that there just seemed to be something missing?
Yeah, it's hard to put my finger on it. All of my books were really directed by the Lord, and as I sat down and started writing, he just kind of seemed to spoon-feed me the material.
Right.
And but there was a real need there, and I saw the need because I work in prison ministry also, and just seeing the need for men to step back into the roles that they used to have, to lead their families,
yep.
to lead society,
mm-hmm.
to be
mm-hmm.
responsible for their... There's too many men that are just leaving their responsibility to
women.
And I think the feminist movement of the 70s probably had a lot to do with the start of that process.
Yep.
Just because women started taking on more roles and being mm-hmm. more aggressive. And mm-hmm. I think a lot of men, because men to me can have real fragile egos.
Oh yeah.
And
yeah.
I think when they started feeling less respect, a lot of men, if they didn't have the maturity in their relationship to God, they just walk away and say, okay, if you want to lead the family, you go ahead, I'm out of here, and go do something else.
No respect.
Mm-hmm. So I think what led to a lot of the decline is just men not feeling respected, and they didn't have the maturity to mm-hmm. to stay in that role and do what they needed to do.
So you say you work in the prison ministry.
Yes.
Where?
We go down with the prison ministry team to the federal prison in Rochester once a month.
Okay.
And I was doing some mentoring with a young prisoner over in Stillwater for a couple of years, too.
Okay. And how have they received this book? Are you able to share it with them?
Actually, not. I did. Well, actually, I shouldn't say that. I had it sent to the prisoner I was mentoring, and he started passing around to some of the other men, and they said, oh, this is great. Okay. I love this, you know. So it's been really helpful to the people that have read it. And I've even had women read it. And they come back and say, I really enjoyed that book, you know, and it helped them to understand their husbands more.
Yeah, understand. Yes.
And so, yeah, it's been well received by the women and men that have read it.
Yes, and I know the people at home want to know, what are you actually, yourself individually, what are you hoping to gain from the book?
Actually, I'm just hoping to see men. Everything I write, everything I do, really my motivation is to see people get closer to God and understand God and His love for them more. And I think as more people grow closer to God, understand His love for them more, that a lot of these problems in society just will go away. Because I think that's one thing that people are lacking. They're feeling a lack of love and appreciation, a lack of respect.
Yep.
And when you really understand God's love for you, it changes your heart.
Yep,
it changes
it
your direction.
It does.
So that's what I'm hoping is just, it'll draw more men into a closer relationship with God.
Yeah. Now, another question. How much of your own life is actually in the book, per se?
I started out giving a snapshot of my life just because I wanted people to see how much the people in our lives affect us, especially when you're young. I took on a low self-image of myself that God has worked overtime on and trying to pull me out of, that developed when I was young just from things my parents said or my dad. Had a little bit of a low self-image and that kind of, and I picked up on that. And so,
you don't seem to have a low self-image at all there.
God is working on it. It's been a long process. And
folks at home, I got to interrupt Dennis. I looked at this picture of this guy, and I was like, that's a handsome guy. That's a guy that's young. He's over 50, and I consider that young. And that's a great picture of him right there. And it's probably your chest there too, Superman chest.
Yeah, no.
But go ahead.
I lost my train of thought.
Go ahead. You were talking about
How we're affected. Because when you're a young child, you really look up to your parents and you try to emulate them. You think everything they say is true. Yes. You think everything they say is accurate. Mm-hmm. And when you get older, if you're not careful to really seek God for your own direction, and really seek God to see who you are, you can easily become what other people tell you you are. And sometimes that's a pretty low image.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, depending on the image your parents have, that can affect your image. And God has a perfect plan for everyone, but it's easy as a child to accept somebody else's image for you.
Oh yeah, a lot of people do that.
And a lot of people do that, and I think that's a real mistake.
Yes.
And it takes some courage, it takes some maturity, it takes seeking God to really overcome that and to find out who He created you to be.
Right.
Rather than who other people tell you that you are.
Right. Now, you've written this book inspired. Do you have a favorite verse of yours that you kind of always go back to when you're kind of, I don't want to say in trouble, but, you know, when things are troubling you?
You know, I know some people have a favorite verse.
I have a lot.
Yeah. For me, I have a lot, too, and it all depends.
Give me one.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in your house forever. His mercy and goodness, as life goes on and I mature in Him, I see His goodness and mercy so much. And I just realize how everything in life, good, bad, ugly, if you're seeking Him and you love Him, it all works for good. And you can't always see that when you're going through it.
Yes.
But looking back on my life from this point, I can see how everything in my life has worked for an increasing good.
Yeah, there's a purpose for everything.
Yeah.
Folks at home, on that note, we're going to take a break for a public service announcement. But you know what? I would feel terrible if I didn't at least thank my sponsors, Endurance Church, located in Brooklyn Park, Minnesota, and Merrick Inn, Bloomington East. I want to thank you for supporting us. We'll be right back after this.
My name is Anthony Bass. I'm originally from St. Albans, West Virginia. I am one of three children from William and Priscilla Bass. My mom was a strong believer. I remember around about, I was 16, 17 years old. She'd wake up every night, every morning, about 5:30, and start praying. And I didn't know she was praying, but she hadn't done this before. And I just remember the living room light would just come on every morning at 5:30. And I'd be like, what? You know, what's going on? But she was growing in her faith. God was doing something in her heart. Her spiritual formation really impacted me. And it was probably the only understanding example I had of Jesus Christ in the home. You know, that was kind of what I took with me to college in Daytona Beach, Florida. The school's called Bethune-Cookman University. Eventually, my last year, I am one of the best cornerbacks in the country, but my draft stock kind of fell because I was hurt. I wasn't running the 4.3, 4.4. I wasn't as mobile as I was before. So instead of being a fourth round draft pick, I ended up being a free agent. So I played for the Vikings for 3 years. And it was a great experience. While I was playing for the Vikings, at that time, God really started dealing with my heart. Man, at that time, I just crammed myself with the Bible, with books, like with writing. Like, it was just me and the Lord. Eventually, I realized, I think I was called into ministry. And once I knew I was called to be a pastor, the chip on my heart, the chip on my shoulder that was really pride in my heart kind of fell off. And I knew a pastor was my calling, and I didn't have that aggression. I made the choice to go back to Virginia Beach to get my Master's of Divinity and Master's of Business Administration. While I was there, there was a larger church that, for whatever reason, had a position open for a youth pastor. And I think my background of being a former football player was appealing to them. And they knew I was getting my education as well from Regent. And they brought me in as a youth pastor. At that point, there were some bad things that happened in my life that kind of took me way off track. And I thought I was done with ministry. And at that point, I received a phone call from somebody in Minnesota who asked me to come up here and plant a church. And at that time, man, Endurance Church started to kind of like be birthed, for lack of a better term. Is we struggled with covering partnerships. We had four churches that have committed to help us and four churches that have not been able to help us. The fifth church that committed to support us was Grace Fellowship. So when Pastor Dave came in and offered support, we were like, okay, great, you know, and, you know, is he serious? But then it happened, like it really happened. So the beautiful thing is now all the people who are with us, my wife and my family and other people who saw the church and not able to kind of follow through on the promises, for lack of a better term, or what they were not in a position to help us, were able to see now, wow. It happened. Like after now, the fifth church, you know, finally it happened. And that was really encouraging to see other people kind of go along with us on that journey. It wasn't just us or wasn't just me. I was able to see God's faithfulness as we remained faithful to Him during the storm.
Welcome back to Motivation. I'm Ron Henderson, the Fitness King. Again, sitting here with my guest, Dennis A. Berg. He is the author of Want to Be a Real Man. You know what? I want to be a real man. People say I'm a man, but you know, I want to be a real man, authentic man. And you're talking about finding that through Jesus Christ.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Now, your book is, you know, if you're looking for a good book, I think it's a great book. It's going to take you a little time to read it unless you're a fast reader. Mm-hmm. I was drawn to chapter 2, The Process to Real Manhood. Can you explain that briefly?
Yeah, to me, the process to real manhood really starts with humbling yourself. And I found that God does not bring adversity on anyone. Mm-hmm. But He will, if you're not seeking Him and you want to go your own way, which is really the original sin of pride, He will let you go that way. And I see so many people that have to hit rock bottom emotionally before they turn to God. And God is just standing there waiting for you to reach that point so He can start lifting you up and training you in who He created you to be in the first place. And so that's where I see the real process to being a real man is just humbling yourself, seeking Him in His Word. And the other thing about seeking Him in His Word, the Bible, is that you can read the same passage over and over for 20 years, and it always says something new to you as you're seeking Him. So he brings out, it is truly a living word, and he truly brings out new meanings to you as you seek him and you mature in that relationship.
Amen. And now, really, do you mentor, can I interrupt you for a second? Do you mentor people too? Is that part of what you do?
Not purposefully, usually, but it's more environmental.
Okay. See, folks at home, I like to set my guests up because I was thinking, I could use a mentor like this guy. And he doesn't even know this, but I'm looking at you, Dennis, and he reminds me of a good friend of mine that was a mentor of mine named Dave. He was a pastor. Okay. And you look just like the guy, and I was thinking, I got my mentor right here.
Yeah, I do mentor, but it's not a purposeful. Well, it's purposeful when it happens, but I don't seek somebody out just to individually mentor.
Amen.
But it seems like I mentor a lot of people as the situations.
Amen. Now, I mean, you wrote the books, I'm sure it motivates you. Any favorite chapters in your book for you that just, you know, really just kind of touch you really hard?
Well, probably a couple. The snapshot of my life, because it really helped me to review my life and understand how I got to where I was and some of the things I've had to deal with because of emotional things, seeds that are put into you when you're a young child. And probably the one on humbling yourself, just the process to becoming a real man. And I've got information in there, just general financial information to help people with budgeting, because that's a big deal for most people. Being a good husband, that's
right.
If you're a good husband, you know, it seems like it's God's natural plan that if the man is leading as he should lead, the wife will just follow along and you'll have a nice union. If the man isn't doing his job and the wife feels pressured to do both jobs, I think that creates a lot of stress in the family.
Yes. Well, I notice you have a chapter, Marriage, God's Gift to Man.
It is. And the Bible says that's our greatest gift, is our wife in life. So.
And how do you address that in the book, per se, briefly?
Well, I address it by just going back to Scripture and showing how God created woman to be a helpmate for man. And interesting enough, if you look at the definitions for husband and wife, they're not very flattering.
Yes.
And if you look at helpmate, there's a lot of meat in there, and it's two people working together, and it actually points to the wife being given to us to help us become better men. And so, it seems that some people would call it nagging, but I say that women have a special gift from God because they have the qualities that help a man. We're good doers, and we're good fixers, and we want to fix problems. And women seem to be the ones that give us the things to fix, or lead us down a path. And they can give us a lot of good information, but our pride sometimes wants to be the one that has all the answers, and so we don't always want to accept the woman's advice or what she has to say as much. So
happy wife, folks, happy life.
Yeah,
right?
That's right.
That's what they
always
say.
There's a lot to that. There's a lot to that.
Happy wife, happy. Okay, and I know you have Achieving Spiritual and Financial Freedom. How is that actually addressed in your book, per se?
Well, it leads back to tithing. You know, tithing is talked about a lot in the Bible, and I know a lot of people today say it's an Old Testament thing. But when you really research it, it shows that tithing is an eternal thing. In Deuteronomy, it says that tithing is meant to teach us to keep God first in our life. And so for me, financial prosperity and freedom really start with keeping God first, giving Him the first of your increase, your tithe, and... I know the first time I went through the Bible was when I was a young man and I had a young family, and I just felt so much pressure of the world coming on me that I just started seeking Him in His Word, and I found that each time I go through the Bible, there's different themes that He brings out to me. The first one is tithing. And I've come to understand that money is the least of our things, and if we're faithful with our money, if we get the money part of it right, a lot of other things fall into place, and so. So I found that tithing was the beginning step, and as you keep your life focused on seeking God and doing what He says is the right path, that that was the beginning step. And then the rest of it is just humbling yourself to follow his pattern for living as a husband, as a father, you know, I guess down that path, just following the advice of in the Bible. But tithing was the first step that I saw that is important in a lot of people.
I would agree.
And I think money is one of those things that's highlighted most people's lives. It's a center focus.
Oh, yeah.
And so I think that's why He talks a lot about money in the Bible, and I think a lot of that is because he wants to make sure that we keep our focus right.
I would agree.
And he said, if we seek him first, he's going to give us all these things. And as I've sought him first, as I've been faithful in my giving, and beyond the tithe, I've seen him bless me in ways I never expected and beyond what I ever expected.
Amen. And if you just tuned in to Motivation, I'm Ron Henderson, the Fitness King, and my guest is Dennis Aberg. He is the author of several books, but more importantly, the book we're talking about today is Want to Be a Real Man. If you're sitting out there, gentlemen, and you want to be a real man, you might want to think of getting this book. First of all, where can they get your book?
You can get it through, I think, any online bookstore.
Okay. How about Amazon.com?
You can get it at Amazon. You can order it through local bookstores.
Superman.
And you go to my website.
Okay, what's your website?
AubergMinistries.com.
Okay, say that again.
AubergMinistries.com. That's AABERG Ministries.com.
Okay, if they have any questions, do you take emails? Can people email you? Some people don't like to give their email cells.
Yeah, no, you can email me. My email is on my website. My phone number is on my website. So you can get all the information about the books on the website.
Good. What other books have you written? Do you mind sharing just briefly?
Yeah, I wrote one on spiritual warfare. It's called a mental block here. Seducing Spirits, the Battle for Your Soul, which kind of describes how we're spiritual beings and describes the spiritual battle we're in. Another one, Jesus' Last Seminar, which breaks down what Jesus taught the disciples in the upper room from the time Judas left to betray him until they went to the garden. So it kind of, and that he, I call that the core of Christian theology. He talked about them living in unity and loving one another and who he was. He defined who he was. So those are, and real man are probably the three.
How do people hear about you? How do people actually hear about what, I mean, you got a good book. How do they hear about you? Do you speak in churches? Do you speak for, you know, companies?
What you know, I haven't been very good at promoting myself. Okay. I've been to Minnesota, the MCMA conferences, Minnesota Church Ministries Association.
Yep, yep.
After I wrote this book, I ended up, God connected me with people that got me connected to Promise Keepers. So I went to their conferences the year this came out, and the book was well received by men at all those conferences.
Amen, amen.
And through those conferences, talking about how God connects the dots, I got connected with National Coalition of Ministries to Men.
Okay.
And so we just came out with a, in cooperation with the American Bible Society, a book, Bible for Men, with a lot of devotionals from ministry leaders around the country for men.
Good. Good. I like that. Yeah. I like it, definitely. Okay, I know the last thing you were talking about is the cost and benefits of real manhood, making the right connections. What is that about, per se?
Well, the cost is just giving up your own plan and seeking God for His plan for your life. Making the right connections. I found that as you seek God, He connects you with the right people at the right time. You might be struggling to know what the next step is, and all of a sudden somebody will say a word that just strikes you in the heart and grabs you. So the way He's worked with me is usually I'll just be going along waiting for Him to give me the next direction. And somebody will come along with just the right word that just sticks in my heart. And so I ponder that and start down that road, and then He connects another dot. Just like that book, I hadn't intended to write that book. He put it on my heart. I just I wrote it. It ended up getting published. That connected me to Promise Keepers, which connected me to National Coalition of Men. Then that connected me with prison ministry. And so all of these things in our lives, we have to be ready to listen to Him, and we have to be ready to make a step in another direction. You can get happy just sitting in a rut and not move and just be unhappy all your life, or you can take a chance and move out when you feel Him moving you.
Yeah, I agree. You know, in listening to you talk about the book, the importance of men, you know, want to be a real man, and all the things that are going on in society right now with the violence, with the murders, even in Minneapolis, Minnesota, I wish more people would actually seek the face of God and get some good materials, because a lot of the things that are going on is because men feel they feel like they're being threatened, their ego, and there's all these things that men battle with, not being secure in themselves. And, you know, maybe you won't pick up the Bible, but you know what? Here's a book that has biblical things in it that's written in such a way that I think it's easy for people to grasp.
Yeah, and that's one of the gifts that God gave me, is just being able to take things and make it uncomplicated. Yeah,
simplify it.
Simplify it.
Yes.
And that's a really good practical guide for all areas of a man's life.
Yeah, I like it.
Talking about the way God connects things, through my website, I was contacted by a pastor from India.
Okay.
Who's working in the slums of Eluru, India.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got an orphanage and supports as many children as he can. And he invited me to come over, and I struggled with it, and then God just told me to go, and I had peace with it.
And you went?
And I went by myself to India for the first time, to the slums of this city.
Mm-hmm.
And my children told me to get all my affairs in order because they didn't expect me to come back.
Right.
And
people always say.
And it was just peaceful, and it was one of the greatest experiences of my life. But it took a lot of faith. It took the peace of God to step out and do that. That was a big step.
When was that?
2014.
Kim, what did you do there when you were there?
Well, to my surprise, he had banners up welcoming me, and he had me preaching in his church in the morning and at night, 3 days that weekend. I went and saw the orphanage children and spent some time with them.
I bet that touched your heart.
Oh, it did.
Oh, yeah.
It did. And they were so appreciative, and they're saying, come back and encourage us some more. You know, it's like, it was a wonderful experience.
They have a couple weeks ago I had Drew Bowen. He's the co-founder of Managers on a Mission.
Mm-hmm.
And they do mission trips, and how that changed his life, mm-hmm. you know? It's, those kids have so little, but yet they have so much.
Yes.
Very interesting, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, that was a very, very beneficial trip for me.
And, you know, on that note, I want to make sure that you get a copy of my book. Folks at home, Amazon.com, it's called Fitness and Faith. I want to give you a copy of that. I hope it's a blessing to you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And I was inspired to write that book, too. I tie in, you know, spiritual fitness, physical fitness. You really have to have balance in your life. And
I call it
balancing the scales.
Yeah.
That's so important, you know.
It is, yeah.
So you can be spiritually fit, but physically you can be a mess.
Yeah.
See, or vice versa.
It's
about having balance in your life.
Yeah, and I agree with that. I've lived by that myself. So I like to stay fit, and it feels good.
Amen, amen.
And especially spiritually fit, and they do go together.
Amen, definitely. Folks at home, Ron Henderson and my guest, Dennis Aberg. He is the author of several books, and more importantly, today we're talking about Want to Be a Real Man. If you got maybe a son, or maybe it's your husband at home. Ladies, you hear me? Maybe your husband's at home, and you're thinking, you know what? He just doesn't seem to get it. You know, you're trying to drag this guy into church, and my church actually is Endurance Church, located in Brooklyn Park. That's right, you got to plug my church, that's important. Pastor Anthony, he expects that, but no, he actually doesn't. But, you know, we have a great church located in Brooklyn Park, Minnesota. But maybe your husband or your son won't go to church. But maybe if they have a book like this, you know, you got a guy, cover up guy, looks like Superman or whatever. You know, maybe think about ordering this book. Give it to him, maybe pick it up for Christmas for him or whatever. You might be surprised how much it will change his life. Today's visit actually changed my life in more ways than he even knows, than Dennis knows. I want to thank you for tuning in to Motivation. On that note, give me your email address one more time or your website, please.
Okay, email. Website is www.abergministries.com, and my email address is
on there too. Okay, so his email is right on the website. I want to thank you for tuning in again for Motivation. I'm Ron Henderson. Until next time, stay motivated, stay blessed, and stay fit in all that you do. We'll see you next time on Motivation. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you.